Hello there, welcome to the garden. Now this week we've had terrible weather. This week we've had four seasons nearly each and every day, starting off with a frost and everything, but we're over it now. Hopefully there's some warm weather hopefully coming through. We've a little bit of catch-up jobs to do today. I've been asked how I sharpen and store the half moon hedge cutter, so I'll finish with it now, so I just show you how I clean it and sharpen it and put it away until the next time I use it. Here's half moon. You'll need some sandpaper, a cloth, a file. This is a diamond sharpener, which you can use any sort of sharpener that you've got. I'll show you those in a moment. A piece of crinkly pipe to put over the blade and a bit of wire to hold it on. So this is how I clean and store my half moon edge cutter. Okay, first of all I rub it with sandpaper. It's best if you do it down. Gloves on, obviously, because that blade's sharp. I just rub the rust and the dirt off roughly. There's no need for too much on it, and then we just do the other side. It's just old sandpaper that I keep for these jobs. Just rub it off, and then with the cloth just wipe the rust off. As you can see, it's rust and earth really, it's not really rust as such. There you go, that's cleaned up half decent, that side as well. I'll just show you the which edge. That is a straight edge on the cutting side, and this side is the beveled edge, so this is the side we sharpen. Now when we've been using it, we've caught odd stones etc. in the lawn, so there's one or two burrs on it, so we get the file and we just take those off. Keep it at all the same angle, just take those burrs off. There's quite a burr there, must have hit a stone, so I'll do that one. See, that's taken that off nicely now. Just on the beveled side. Remember, these are your cutting sides here, so really get those nice and sharp. Just like that. Just take the burrs out. I just rub round. The little bit of a burr there needs to come off. That's fine. Now we use the diamond sharpener. I use the roughest edge first and then work down to the smoothest on it. And it's just a case of rubbing this round. Yeah. You can actually feel the diamonds biting into the steel. So you know it's cutting quite well. Then go down one. Again, same way, take it round. Just stroke it round. Don't forget the edges. And there your cutters. Then down one again. We're getting there now, look. And then red is the final. So what I do, I go little circles at quite an angle just to take the edge to a blade. All the way round. And then that looks okay. Little bit there, look. That's fine. Then turn it over. This is the back of the blade, and just sweep round. That'll just take any burrs off that you've made. Now that, believe me, is one very sharp half moon. Now to store it, I rub it with a bit of vegetable oil. I don't use engine oil or any of those sprays. Vegetable oil is going back onto the garden, and it's from from the garden, so, well, it's from plant, so it should be all right. Just close that and then just rub that in. Careful now, because you have got quite a blade on it. Just like that. Then do the back. There you are. That's the blade oiled. Now I get a piece of this bendy pipe and I've put a cut down it so I can feed it onto the blade, you see, like that, over like that, and then I just stand astride it to hold it. It's not the best position. Then a piece of wire just to hold and twist on. Take one side of the handle and over the, I'll take my gloves off, one side over the handle and round that side, you see, and the other one over this side and just round just to hold the wires in place, then it won't slip off. And that's how I sharpen it. I've got these in my shed on the wall. It just pushes in. I don't know where we got them from, but they weren't expensive. And then when it's ready for storage in the shed, I just push that into it and then it sits there ready for next time we want to use it. I do this to all my tools as I finish with them, especially after the season. I oil them down with the vegetable oil and store them away in the shed. Then they're all ready for next time. We'll nip down now with the trug and we'll harvest some of those cauliflowers that hopefully have survived the bad weather this week, and that they'll be in ready for the weekend. There might be a few radish ready as well. We've got some salad stuff in, so we'll see what we've got. We're down at the bed A, which is brassicas. We're just harvesting the last few of the collies now. There's two that are ready and the rest are still hearting up. If you just look at this one, you see it's not quite ready yet. We'll just leave that one, but we'll take these that are ready. This one, I'll just cut it and then I can show you it. Right, this one, as you can see, the weather's took its toll on it a little bit, but it's still usable. That can still be used, that'll be fine. I will pick the bits up afterwards, I can show you. Now this one, that one, as you can see, is perfect. So we've got one that's not so good and one that's absolutely beautiful. Six more still to come. Hopefully we can get them out before we can reset, then prepare the bed and reset it as we did the first one. There's one or two, as you can see, just ready now. You don't want these are the free ones from Browns, so you don't want them much bigger than that. These have been out in all weathers. The only protection they've had is this mesh, and I think for what weather we've had this week, they've done exceptionally well. There's the radish, just enough there for using straight away. The rest of the frame seems to be doing rather well. The carrots are coming up well. Even the second set of parsnips are coming up well. Pulling onions are doing rather well. But these have all survived very bad weather this week. I'm very pleased with those. Now the second frame, as you can see, has got lettuce in. Done very, very well. It just shows how good this mesh is. Have a look at the cabbage plants that are waiting to go into the next mesh tunnel behind us. They're fine, a little bit on the dry side, but that's no problem. I'll nip down and give them a can of water. They've done exceptionally well. While we're down in the garden, we'll go to bed B, which is the main crop potatoes. I need to put some feed on between the rows and get them ridged up. They are beginning to push through a little early, but so we'll have to get them ridged. So that's the next little job. Here we are at the potato bed. I'm going to put the fertiliser on and then rake it in, then ridge up. The fertiliser I'm using is from Proctor's. It's a mineral base. It is a potato fertiliser. It's 10, 10, 10. Now potatoes like a fair bit of nitrogen, but careful you don't put too much on or you'll get brown lines inside the potato. Use any good potato fertiliser, but say don't, be careful you don't put too much nitrogen on them. You get too much top anyway. I try to do the measure of one jam jar per run, and then at least I'm controlling how much I'm putting on. If you go putting hands full on, you'll never know how much you've got on. This is a good way of doing it. So I spread this on, right down the sides, and then ridge them up. It's a granulated fertiliser and it's a lot easier to put on, especially like today. You've got that little bit of wind, it will blow powdered fertiliser everywhere. The potatoes have been ridged a little. It was beginning to show through and the bad weather was on its way, so I had to quickly ridge them to cover the tops so that the cold north wind, which strikes directly up this garden, would have took them out. But they're safe and they're nice now. I see there's one or two actually started to pop through again. So I'll get these ridged up and show you how I do it. Now the soil has been so dry, as you can see it's quite lumpy, but the rain and etc. that we'll get over the next few weeks will knock these lumps off. So I just rake quickly down the sides where we put the fertilizer in and then we ridge it. Then I go ridging. I use this long-handled rake, if you like. It's only got 5 prongs, but it does an excellent job. And then I just go down, get them all up. Any big lumps, try and break them. If you're in the clay, you'll have a bit of a job with them, but you get them as they dry. So do one side, stand in the ridge and pull the other side up. Try and do half so you leave that half for that side. Then when I finished, I just drag the row down each line so it loosens it. The other thing that I'll show you is because we left plenty of room between the potato lines, we've got lots of room to heal them up. We can fertilize properly, and then when it comes to spraying, we can get down the rows nicely. As you can see, loads of room. There's load more soil within the bottom of the ridge still to pull up as they grow as well. Just any potatoes that pop through, we can just cover it up because we'll have the room to do it. It also lets the air run through your potatoes, which also helps against the blight. And to put them too close together is a nightmare when you come to lift them anyway. These are the onions we planted last week. They've took the bad weather quite well. They're standing very, very proud now. They're fine. I've had one or two I've had to go and fetch back where the birds have pulled them out. The broad beans are standing well. The broad beans have had a bit of a bashing with the weather down here. They are showing flower now, so they seem all right. They seem a bit washed out with the weather, but they'll be fine. I have ridged the early potatoes up, fertilized them and ridged them up. I've got one more row still to do on this side. There's one or two showing too. I'll get those done today, hopefully. When I came down this morning to let the chickens out, we had a little rabbit running about, so I had to chase that off the garden this morning. The very babies are the ones that actually get through the wire. Once they get a bit bigger, they tend to stop. I don't know whether it got out or whether it's still in. I can't find it now. We're on our way back up the garden now. I just picked my chug up. The nice little harvest for a stormy week. I've been, Di said to use this one that is a little bit gone over. She's going to make some cauliflower cheese with that one. This one's not though. I'm going to have that one for my dinner. It's beautiful. Radish, we'll have those for lunch. We have a little salad for lunch, so we'll just share those out. They look very nice and I know they'll taste nice. On our way up the garden, as you can see, one of our chicken, her name is Bee, has gone broody. So Diane's sent for some eggs and we've popped them under her, and we've also put some in the incubator in the house. So now we'll be watching those and see how they get on. I've just taken her water container out to take it to the house and put some fresh in for her. But she's really, really grumpy. The wire, we put the wire in just to stop the other birds from sitting with her. When I came down this morning, I took it off and let her have a run. And when I come to put it back on, she'd got another bird sat with her in there, so we have to keep her a little bit isolated while she sits on the eggs. I just popped that on there, look, just to keep the other birds off her a bit, give her a bit of peace. Right, so that's Bee sorted as we came past. We'll keep you posted on how she gets on with those eggs. Now we're on our way up to the greenhouse. A little bit congested up there, so we'll have to fight our way in. And just while we walk past the lilac, I just thought I'd show you it. I can't remember its name. I know it's a French name. We'll look it up at some stage for you, but it smells absolutely beautiful. It fills the whole garden with a beautiful perfume. It really is a nice plant, and no problem. It's beautiful. We'll make our way up to the greenhouse now. We've fought our way into the greenhouse. As you can see, it's absolutely full. I've had to keep it really shut down all week, so tomatoes have stretched to decent sized plants now. The geraniums are all coming into flower, fuchsias are budding up. Everything's looking very, very good and growing very strong. I'm well pleased with it. We've had no frost damage or cold damage in here at all. What I've done though, because of the cold weather, I've held off with the watering, so everything in here is really, really dry at the moment. I didn't want it sat wet and then get cold, else it would have really had an effect on them. The other thing with not watering, what it's done, it's actually brought the tomatoes into flower now, so, which is a good thing. So the trusses won't be too far up the stems. I'll just show you. Can you see there? There's the flowers. Flowers that will carry the first truss of tomatoes. So if I drop that into its main pot at 2 inches down, that'll give me a 6-inch gap for the first truss. That's absolutely perfect now. We do that. Just looking around, they're all, because they've been dried out a little bit, they're all showing flowers now. They're all getting the truss, the sets on, the flowers on. Happy with that. Everything's ready for a drink of water. The geraniums are coming into flower. What we will do is we'll, like this one, that's salmon, so we'll just drop a label in it. It's a little bit of water burn there, look. That's no problem. But again, the fall of flower, and really we didn't want flower, wanted more growth. But what I should do, when I water them, I'll pop a bit of feed in them. A feed that is like a 5-5-5. I don't want to give them too much potassium or too much nitrogen just yet. But they're doing fine. And these are all the overwintered ones. As we go round, as I put the label on, etc., and feed them, then I'll cut these stalks off now, get some sharp secateurs, cut those off. And when it's in colour, label with the colour, then down I know where to put it in the garden. You've got some very pretty geraniums there. And you can see there's lots and lots of flower and lots of good growth. The fuchsias, they're all showing flower now. We'll do the same, we'll put the colours on so I can colour coordinate her baskets, etc. The standard fuchsias are doing well. I shall bring the taping machine up and get them all taped onto the canes now and take these side shoots off. Doing rather well. Growing very well. When you see this light colouring on the top leaves, it shows they really are growing well. These are the plants the cuttings that we took out of that first batch we bought. The main cuttings are at the back, still ready for potting, look very dry, but they'll be fine. These are the main plants. As you can see, they're all doing rather well. So some more tomatoes there. These are sun gold. As you can see, the flowers are setting very, very well now. Happy with those. One or two at the back stretched a little. If it stretches too far, just take the top off to a side shoot and let the side shoot go up. Perfectly all right. These are the plum tomatoes. Feel very, very dry, but they're quite happy. They've took some cold weather on that top. Absolutely perfect. Peppers, yellow and red, still be want potting up very soon. We'll just have a look at the tomato grafts that we took for another week, and we'll be cutting the rootstock away, okay? So this one, I've took the bag off because of the bad weather. I hope you can see, there's the graft under this wrap here. It looks fine. It doesn't look any problems. Next week, we'll cut this one off, and then hopefully it'll grow up this side and up. And remember, if you do this and you do grow them on, you must stake them well, because it'll always be a weak joint just there. Give it another week, we'll take that one out, take it out the pot, cut that one off, and let's see if we can grow it on that one. If we just have a look, if you remember, that's fine. These leaves are still showing well, these leaves are still showing well, so it shows that there's no real damage being done with us doing the graft. We can't quite see it through the grafting tape, but it looks fine. Now the red one, same, grown well, grafted, looks all right. They're together still, but the main thing we'll know is when we cut these off. If that goes down in a few hours, we know we've failed. But very good. I think grafting clips as well as that, because these are very difficult to tie, especially with these hands. So next time we'll put clips as well. These will take, I'm quite sure of it. If there'd been any problems, you would have been able to see it now in the leaves, but they're fine. And they've had cold weather. And they're ready for a drink. But the thing is with the tomatoes, if you keep throwing water at them all the time, you're just going to get massive growth and no flowers. If you want to get them to flower, try to dry them out a bit. Be very careful though, you don't over dry them, else it'll go into wilt and you'll never get the plant back up again. It's amazing how quick they will flower if you let them dry out. That's it for the green. It's actually getting warm in here. That's the first time we've had warmth for the week. It's wonderful. Because the sun's now come out, we were going to spray this morning, so we'll leave it till this evening when the sun's gone down a bit, and we'll mix the soapy spray up and we'll spray those fruit bushes. and we'll feed the blueberries. Must do that this week. So we'll see you later then. It's now later in the day. It's overcast and we're going to do the spraying for the aphid. I'm going to do the mix in my knapsack, which is easier for me to do a 10 litre mix in this. Now if you're using a 1 litre sprayer, just put about half a teaspoonful of washing up liquid in that and then just give it a good shake and spray. But we will use the knapsack, so I'll show you how I prepare it. But you can use any washing up liquid. Don't use any washing up liquid, obviously it's got bleach in, or any antibacterial mixtures, avoid those. Just straight washing up liquid is fine. My knapsack has got 10 litres of water in it and I'm going to add 12 ml of washing up liquid. Right, so we can just pop that in. Now with it being just washing up liquid, it's quite safe to put your hand in and wash them out so you can get it all in. Now remember, if it's windy out there, don't spray. I'm using a knapsack, they're very very useful. I do a lot of spraying when I go out, so I like to take a good charge, but then again I only ever half fill it because fill it to the top is far too heavy. Now another thing to remember while you're spraying with washing up liquid, we're only using a very low dose. Now if you're using a stronger dose than what we're using because you think it will do better, that's fine. But remember, you must wash it off after a few hours if you put a strong dose on. This little bit we're putting on has no harm at all. 12 ml to 10 litres is fine. Anything stronger, give it a few hours to work and then you must wash it off because you don't want to burn your plants. Right, so here we are in the fruit cage. We're going to start spraying. Now as you can see, there's definitely no sun out today. We know that there are a few green fly on these. If you look carefully, I can actually see one or two flying about. So we'll get them sprayed. Now the idea is to go in and go underneath the leaves. So you're spraying on the back of the leaves if possible. So just work your way all through it and then go to the other side and do that side. Don't worry. These are fruiting very nice, but the washing up liquid won't affect the fruit at all. And looking at them, there's only one or two on. They're actually flying about. So I'll get on. It'll make a bit of noise, so if you bear with me. Go underneath. Go in and push them about. Go right to the bottom, don't forget the bottom ones. It's pushing one or two flyers off, so we're stopping some from laying anyway. Right, so that's this side of that bush done. I'll go and do the other side now. I'll just spray this side up now. Keep the sprayer moving, give it a good wetting. It doesn't matter if you spray the camera person because it's only soap. There you are, so we'll do exactly the same with this gooseberry bush. Now remember, don't start spraying over the top. You really need to get in and underneath so your spray is coming up onto the back of the leaves. There are a few on them, so it needs doing. Alright, so here we go then. Just I've got it on a low pressure, not blasting it. If I could just stop a second, here are a lot. Can you see how that root leaf is getting wrinkly? That's the sure sign that there are aphid on it. And there they are on the back, look. So it's time once doing. Same again, go underneath and make your way around the bush. Underneath those top branches, that's where your aphid will be, up here. Right up. We're not going to kill every single aphid in the first one, but normally I can do this twice a week, it doesn't hurt anything. Get right underneath. It's these little top bits where they'll gather. But with a fine spray, it soon gets onto them all. That's that little gooseberry bush sprayed now. Gooseberries are swelling up nicely on them, like some rain, just to swell them up a bit quicker, but they'll be fine. I shall now work my way through all these fruit and make sure they're all done today. But I can do them again in 2 or 3 days, it's no problem. It doesn't hurt anything to give them a good spray with washing up liquid. I know normally when you're spraying some pesticides go over the top, but with us doing so, you need to spray from the bottom. You need to try and contact the aphid itself, because all this soap does is washes the coat, the wax coat off the aphid, and normally then they just die because they drowned in the water as well. Okay, so that's the spraying done. I'll carry on because conditions are absolutely ideal. It's overcast, there's no wind, and we'll get the whole of these fruit bushes all sprayed and done, and that'll do in here for a day or two. So that'll be it for this week. I hope you've enjoyed it. We'll hope for better weather next week, but I'm sure there's some nicer weather coming. Such a lot to do still. Hopefully we'll see you next week. Bye now.